thank you, Scott. What is it? Just replication is just a great bit of flattery there. So thank you, Scott. Thank you, everyone, for making this wonderful opportunity available now for many years over. And the Expo continues to grow in size and popularity and in advocacy. So thank you very much for that. I'm a staunch supporter of the work you do. In the 20th Congressional District of New York, the capital region that I represent, incubation, innovation, invention is fast afloat as we go forward with the sorts of responses we require as a state in New York and as a nation to some very aggressive numbers that have been established out there in terms of reducing carbon and methane emission. So those are necessary reductions, I believe. For the deniers of carbon out there, get with it. There is an economy that grows with innovation, and we need to embrace those theories of reducing carbon emission. So to respond to that adequately, research is required, development of new ideas is required, and the aggressive implementation of efficiency standards and certainly renewable energy being embraced in the concept are those essential matters that will make us respond and achieve those goals that are so critically before us. The efforts that we made in recent past with the reauthorization of the tax credits that allow for incentives to encourage that sort of activity are important. But I would point out that, you know, my concern aside about the length of that reauthorization and the continuing of incentivizing fossil-based fuels aside, there needs to be parity, I believe. We cannot cut out any opportunities. If we're going to have a, you know, all-of-the-above strategy in our energy arena, we need to have an all-of-above strategy for those concepts of innovation and for renewables. And so I think it's important for us to take those production tax credits and those investment tax credits and sweep them broadly in a parity situation so that no one is set aside or avoided in the equation. There have been good opportunities for geothermal, absolutely, for combined heat and power, certainly, and for fuel cells. They show great promise as we move forward, and they also embrace scalability. So let's make certain we do that with every bit of intensity as we be inclusive, as we become inclusive in the process going forward. Now, again, we need to make certain that as we embrace these new technologies, that we have flexibility with our grid system. You know, we passed a measure in the House that failed miserably as an energy bill with the grid system. There is a need to invest in our grid system so that it is flexible and at the same time being open to all sorts of opportunities for invention, innovation, and renewables. And not straining in any way or denying capacity response in the networks. So we can do that, I'm certain, with grid upgrades and grid investment and research. Now, I've been named a conferee by my caucus, by Leader Pelosi, on the energy bill. And hopefully we'll come to the table and have that conference because it is so critical to not only the energy arena, but our economy in general. What I'd like to see done is greater emphasis on the weatherization program, making certain that we go forward with that program and the state energy program that is always at risk and we have the right to restore it or reauthorize it. We also need to be aggressive, I believe, about research that applies to various elements of responding to the international agreements that are made on carbon emission. And if we're going to do that, we need to be aggressive with research. We need to invest heavily in the Department of Energy's Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency Program. That division requires our support, and it requires additional dollars so that the investments there will spur the sort of public-private partnerships that are essential to grow the economy and the response to the decarbonization effort. And then finally, as an example, I stand strongly in defense of taking natural gas fed turbines and providing for greater efficiency. If we take what is a 60% standard and raise it to 65%, that may sound like a trite outcome, but it reduces heavily the amount of electrons that are saved, and it reduces immensely the amount of dollars that are invested by consumer and those that require the placement of those turbines. So that creates manufacturing jobs galore. It relates to a sound, I think, sound energy policy that can then transition itself into sound policy that is about making it in America. So our energy policies directly affect our economic recovery. They affect, I believe, our sense of invention, of innovation, incubating, fostering these ideas and concepts in a way that creates new jobs. So to the deniers of carbon, get on the program, let's go forward, let's have a sound investment in the grid to make it all interconnect well, and to invite that sort of strategy, these new outcomes to be able to be placed effectively. Let's go on and have the vision that's required. Let's forget about the denial. Let's be aside with the 97% of the scientists community that says there is a need for carbon reduction, methane reduction. Let's do it today, not wait another decade or two, as some would have the choice be in Washington. Okay, let's go and get them. Energy and Red Attack.
Congressman, I just want to comment on two things. First, the reason we have this breadth and depth of the clean energy technologies, efficiency, all the renewables, and storage here is to deal exactly what you said, is that policy ought to build the entire blend of solutions and not just the flavor of the month. And the second point I have to use, I want to thank you for sticking with us and being there and being a vision leader. It's very important.
Thank you for having